And then the whole thing, the two things are always there, which is going on with the post neurons during the diagnosis, either through real life experiments. If you're working at large and the theory is against the classical, you have a large number of local degrees of freedom, and this isn't just working at large lambda. What it means is really you're looking at a large separation of scales in the spectrum. And in particular, if you look, for example, the confining examples, you could be doing it interesting. What large lambda really means is that the mass of the light is in 2 megons has to be much, much heavier, much, much bigger than the mass of the light is in 1 megon. And you can look at QCD, for example, the QCD, you're not at large lambda in any given sense. It's really excitation of QCD at the same mass as the supergravity excitation of QCD. So this is not a theory of the real world, but it's a toy model that can be useful when you don't have access to the real thing. So I'm going to spend quite a bit of time talking about applications to QCD, but probably been less of emphasis on this in the recent years, but we have a lot of talk on applications to convex metaphysics, so I think we might be able to talk about a little bit more time on QCD aspects. In particular, I'm going to talk about the property in hydrodynamics, energy loss, and thermalization. Now, there's no talk here about the case of gravity corresponds to that, just mentioned the property, but still the little success of the whole problem. So what is this property? This property is something similar to what we've seen in any undergraduate class of physics. This property says that in a fluid, if you have different layers moving at different velocities, there's a force per unit area that acts from one layer of the fluid on the other layer of the fluid, and this property then measures for you the force per unit area, per unit velocity gradient, so that a unit velocity gradient, like a force per unit area. By the momentum. So think of it as a diffusion of momentum, right? Momentum moves upwards due to viscosity. The reason that it's interesting in QCD is because people can do experiments with negative viscosity of QCD. The way that happens is in heavy ion colliders, what you do is you slap the gold nuclei or the lead nuclei into each other, they collide, you form this quark-gluon liquid or quark-gluon plasma, whatever reason they overlap. And then by watching how this, people often call it the iron state reason, how this expands, the hydrodynamically modeling behavior of this, you can extract the viscosity of the liquid you created. And what's happening in qualitative is the high pressure, the narrow region has high pressure expands faster than the long region which has low pressure. Because it can be quantified by the velocity of QCD, a force per unit area per velocity gradient, force per unit area, and that I unit would be measured in Pascal, and inverse velocity, unit velocity gradient, as units per second, because it should be measured in Pascal seconds, but there's a more convenient unit, the centigrade, which is 10⁻³ Pascal seconds, so the reason people use it is because water in this unit is roughly because you have 1 centigrade water, so the hydrodynamic name, so that the fluid is yet out the most denied unit of water at the viscosity of form. Here is less viscous at the viscosity of 0.02 centigrade, honey to 10 membranes, and anywhere between 2,000 and 10,000 centigrade. This is the famous experiment that actually measures viscosity. You're like, most even guess, we have seen this by now, but just a good opportunity to pass up on. But this is a very famous experiment. It's not famous for the basic physics question, that is some famous, because the longest running laboratory experiment on the planet. It was started in 1930 at the University of Queensland, is still ongoing, so it's running for over 8 years. But people try to do is to try to measure the viscosity of pitch, which is the sticky black liquid, which you can see in the picture. And it is 8 years it has been running so far, 8 drops fell. 8 drops, nobody has ever seen one of those drops fall, but still they believe they must have somehow come through the little marathon. After 10 drops, they installed a video camera, but unfortunately now comes through for drop number 8. But still, haven't seen the drops, but from this, you can get almost and people from the exact viscosity of pitch, they find it to be 2.3 times 10 to the 11 centigrade, about certain orders of magnitude larger than the viscosity of water. There's a number that you keep in mind, when we asked about it, but the difficulty large number. Let's compare this to another famous experiment that measures the viscosity of something, namely the MRI collider and pitch. That measures the viscosity of the quark-gluon plasma, which is absolutely, give or take a factor of 2 in experimental accuracy, the viscosity of 10 to the 14 centigrade, 3 orders of magnitude larger than the viscosity of pitch. That was very under the press release by the Brookhaven National Laboratory saying that the degree of collectivity has rapid thermalization and extremely low viscosity of the matter being formed is most perfect fluid to do better when you compare. So the three facts presented in the slide is running my watch bird of people in the deck of the smoking at the time. But no, they're probably also heard from our sprinting, right? They already knew this, what had happened at that time already. What the bunch of sprinting is that calculated the viscosity of one of the strongly coupled foil models. In fact, those people want to generalize it to many of the photographic foil models, and they found it quite inherent in the photographic foil models. It isn't A, I said, it isn't the viscosity itself that might run, but the viscosity to entropy, the entropy density ratio that takes it by now famous value of 1.45. That's a lot of good things for us. What the calculation did is it pinpointed the right of thermal. It's not the viscosity is lower than the Brookhaven National Laboratory, the viscosity to entropy density ratio. That's really low. It's about 1.45, which is a factor of 2 for the quark-gluon plasma produced in it, and it's enormous for pitch. For pitch, it's still 30 orders of magnitude larger than for water. But if you look at hydrodynamics, you roughly should do something like this, because what you're measuring is not just the force, but the force from mass, which is really governing the changes in momentum. But this is what you're telling them, what are the good points to look at? This is something that you should compare between the two. If you take a force part figure, if you prefer to estimate to get something that's an order of magnitude larger than that, and if you see that 1.45, 1.45 is within a factor of 2 of what you're delivering. This is some idea of how large the quantity becomes from some series. There's one more thing that's called the transistor effect, and the same quantity would be very large if you're coupling, it's 1.45, strong coupling. So maybe this is a bound, we know these things, it's not a bound, we also know this homology, but another holographic coupling has been done. The carbon pattern found in one of the ends of two gates used to fundamental mechanism, we actually call it 5. You get an 8 over x, which is 1.45 minus a little, that resulted in obtaining large engines. So this is a tiny connection, but the tiny connection goes the wrong way. 1.45 is certainly not a bound, we have explicit examples where you can drop it below 1.45. Whereas we found it's quite inherently higher curvature corrections can get either way of 1.45, even though maybe bigger or larger, but it's higher curvature corrections, of course, any calculation results in only reliable if there's more correction. So we have reliable control over calculation, they can violate 1.45. That's enough to say that it's not a bound. Some of recent developments, but something I'm not going to talk much about, but one really interesting application came out is taking all the hydrodynamics of the derivative expansions, like low energy gravity capsules, because you get the non-derivative terms, you might wonder, what about two derivative terms? They all evolved for two derivative terms, so they were all calculated in entropy forces in 2007. And the interesting thing about the two derivative terms is that people actually need them when they do these hydrodynamic calculations, that exactly the copy of the actual experimental data. When suddenly, if your experimental value of 8 over S, they claim the measure here, right, the LSD, but goes into the hydrodynamic code, and the hydrodynamic code has to just shuttle this, it's going through the technical corrections, because hydrodynamics is just a different terms, it's 8 causes. It has most of the propagate faster than the speed of light, if it has a very large base number. That's of course conceptually not a problem, like hydrodynamics is a long wavelength approximation. If very strong day, make most propagation happen with speed of light, then that's outside the realm of the liberty of the theory. You should just throw them away. But in the computer, you can't do it. You want to simulate that in the computer, you have to then computer something that's going to happen to the short wave control. You want to somehow make them cause, you want to regulate it. If you send all the hydrodynamic forces to do it automatically, you include the integration of the hydrodynamic becomes the cause of theory, or the A cause of the theory. You have to include them. But once you include them, you have to include them to some number. The people experimentally on the computer, the numerical system, it's that it's irrelevant by a factor of two. The answers don't change much. That's how they reassure them that you take all the terms running forward and that there's a theory in order to create numerics. But the values they're using are the values for the numbers. You need to have a ballpark figure for the second order hydrodynamic forces to the next word, the same as the limit, no. Less than all of magnitude is still a good answer. But these are really important ballpark figures, is all they need, and that's what the point model provides. But I do want to talk about this enormous transport, because that's the area of hydrodynamics, the most activity has been happening on in the last few years. Let me follow a presentation by Kadir and Son in a very different paper by the school in the subject in order to introduce you what enormous hydrodynamics is all about. In the chapter of enormous hydrodynamics, what is interested in is the body capacity of the current. It's supposed to be a current of a conserved charge, and if you conserve charge, you care about in an angle either with electricity, you see the varying number of electric charges. Here is a formula that calculates for you the conserved current for one of those two conserved charges. Here is a varying number of electric charges, the formula for each of them. There are two sources for this current. One term might say there's a magnetic field in there that they call the chiromagnetic effect, and the other term has a velocity in there, the curl of the velocity. So either magnetic field or the curl of the velocity can rise to the enormous current. But the thing out front is a new find the actual chemical potential that makes the whole subject experimentally really difficult because it's average, so there's no separation between the chiromotion by chiromotion out of plasma. Average between the micro is zero, and hence there will be no current. But event by event, you know, what mechanics think that have a zero expectation value in my solar fluctuation. Event by event, you find may or may not be zero, the energy should be zero, but how large the fluctuation is, we don't really know. Now, if you think there's still a very many to do between, so whether this is experimentally acceptable or not, opinion is different. But the important thing is that, theoretically, these coefficients, once given you five, what is still lacking are the two coefficients, and these two coefficients are completely dominated by the norm. They're given by finite diagrams, you calculate them, decoupling and extrapolate the strong coupling, you see the exact answer. Those coefficients you can calculate exactly. And what those give you reliably is the relative size of the variant relative size of symmetry, because they have a common recycling outcome. Here, the value of the only, for these papers, you can see interesting things, for example, is the chiral vortex effect, the dominant vortex vorticity, is suggested that by accident is zero sitting there, that sum up the finite diagram. Because this can make a few predictions to what should happen at the wick or the LSD when you collide on the ion. There should be a varying number separation of the same sign as electric charge separation. The ratio between the variant symmetry and the charge symmetry should increase at the center of mass and it is lower, and that's due to the fact that this guy comes with the chemical potential, and the chemical potential gets higher as you collide with lower energy to create higher density. In the last couple of weeks, you know, of course, just looking at the formula, the magnitude of the ratio of charge to variant symmetry that's usually fixed by the enormous catalyst. So for this, you could discriminate between the DNA and the DNA. What has this to do with the logic? If you share this formula, so the connection between the chiromagnetic effect and the norm, you never take the norm before. That's what the norm is doing, right? The norm is telling us, you take on the electric magnetic field, the currents aren't conserved. But what does the chiromagnetic effect have to do with the norm? So there's no norm that we know of the tensor involved, that the effective effect, then you have the tensor, if something goes around in circles, some current is conserved. Yet you find the formula completely dominated by the norm, which is saying exactly that. So the way people ran, some of the concept facts was biologically. The first time people have seen there's a connection between the chiromagnetic effect and the norm, was an ABCC calculating that it found the extra transfer coefficient in the holographic calculator. It's all entirely given by a certain minus term of the gravitation calculator. The strong coupling is given by an anomaly. That makes you wonder, if it's given by an anomaly, the strong coupling, if it's only given by an anomaly, it all happens. But it took a long time before people came to Kalman, after Kalman, and showed them this connection. The final piece by Thomas Rocker, who put the two things together, they put together that they know the actual anomaly that they found in the magnetic field, that's what the known anomaly does. And they showed together that the requirement is entropy current as opposed to entropy divergence. So it's not clear what those two things are. The two things are the letter saying the fluid somehow moves towards equilibrium as it evolves under its own flow, but if they try to bring it together, it's the known anomaly, then you see that the trial volume effect is a mandatory consequence. That sounds like a rather roundabout thing. By now, people have better arguments, but either argument is the same answer. Yes, the paper from this year, the basic emulator is not. You can go beyond the entropy current argument. The entropy current of the local argument is very strong. All you need to require is that if you put your system, put your fluid into a non-zero gravitational background, it just represents some sort of static in its equilibrium configuration. But this class, my non-zero gravitational background, you take any metric to define by tuning vector, and then saying static configuration should exist, what people mean to say doesn't affect me, is that you want to have the edge right on the decision generating functional and arbitrary spectrum, which is defined by tuning vector. It's just saying that this industry asks the fluid to somehow come to rest. It's one thing under the rest configuration of the fluid. If you do this, you can put in the vector decline, and exactly this produces the sum of Rocker results for the chiromagnetic effect, which might be dominated by the anomaly. It's suspected that the entropy current argument is an argument based on the static configuration of the equivalent, but it's not clear whether they are. There's a third version of this, they can derive the same connection between anomaly and TV using both identities, but you have to include global both identities. Both identities are related to the existence of the Euclidean time surface. And a byproduct of this nice study is that you also get a hand on transport, things that look like transport coefficients but aren't. When people calculate the second-order hydrodynamics, they already found that some of the things that don't be hydrodynamic transport coefficients could actually be calculated by purely Euclidean correlation functions. You have actually things you can't calculate them enough. And it's also clear at this point how you disengage. This thing really requires dynamics, which means that that's static. This is technique you automatically calculate all transport coefficients which are transport coefficients in the size. You can calculate all the transport coefficients which are determined by equilibrium properties. It allows you to get rid of those from the set of numbers that are hard to calculate, and the only things that are left over for you to do are the really complicated ones, the ones that are driven by dynamics. Let me end this section with a puzzle, because it all sounded very exciting and nice, but there's one more term I haven't told you about. It was all a few temperature that I had in my form that I wrote down before. If you do a second finite temperature, you find that if you look at the chiral vortex effect, that is kind of right for you, the vortex conductivity, which we can do with many U1s, you find that one piece is given by the anomaly, which depends on the other two chemical potentials. Then there's an extra piece that goes like the temperature created an independent chemical potential. And if you look at the coefficient of the thing, it seems to be given by a mixed gravitational gate anomaly, to be calculated with a decoupling from the density, science given by the anomaly, to be calculated with long coupling, find it given by Einstein and the 5-dimensional bias. It seems to be true, it's always given by an anomaly, but not until tonight, there's no paper out in the archive, it's actually that there's actually some connection between this and the anomaly. I've been informed, after a minute of light, there's a paper coming up by Jensen, Lothar Mayam, and Jaron, which is actually going to be